this way, please. I want to do the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. On our hearts.
Thank you, Tom, for a very interesting introduction. Tom goes back a long ways with the late, great Chris Siros as well. He was in Chris's junior high concert orchestra when Tom was young. Chris was never young. We all looked up to our teachers and everything. But we're glad to have you here today, and we're very thankful that Tom Reddick from VFW Post 2195 could help us present the colors and do the pledge. We've worked with the Post for 10 years, and they have been to virtually every concert we've done since we worked with them, and it's always nice to have that. It's always nice to have veterans in the audience as well. Today, we have an interesting concert. It's a lot of different types of music. This is our jazz band, obviously. Our concert band has over 80 members now. We used to play here as well, and we got just a little north of 65, and we had to find another place to go. So we do our concerts with the concert band at Lowry Freshman Center. We continue to do our jazz band here because it fits very nicely. The band fits, the audience fits, and it's great to play concerts here for Tom and with Tom's people because he has supported us from the very beginning when we were really struggling, and he welcomed us with open arms. The concert today has some big band standards in it, has a little rock and roll along the way, and a couple of Latin features. So let's have a concert. Ray Akin, Associate Director, and Little Brown Jug. Thank you. of famous tunes from the great Glenn Miller Band. Now we're going to change completely to a 1973 piece called Chameleon, which you will probably understand as soon as it starts. We're going to do a little show and tell. Hey, Mike.
Yo.
Let's do the 12 bars, 12 note riff here. Okay, listen to this. You know, it's just like a kid. Give them something to do. And anyway, thank you, Mike. You will hear that 12 note riff through the whole piece. It's the way it starts, and we'll be going along. There'll be all this stuff going on. If you listen to the bass line, Tony, Mark, Jim back there are still doing that. Herbie Hancock did this, and the original version was 15 minutes and 44 seconds. That's a long time. They didn't get much play time on the radio, so they cut it down. And it's nearly every band still plays it, including us. Okay, Chameleon. Complete change of pace. Can you imagine that bop, bop, bop for 15 minutes? No, the band can't, we can't either, but anyway. It does, some of you will go home thinking of that all day, no matter what we do, trust me. But the next song, contemporary, from one of the great singers of our time now, John Legend, All of Me, he wrote this for his fourth album, and dedicated to his current wife, Chrissy, Tegan. They were not married at the time. They were going together, and he's working on this album. He wrote this song for her. They subsequently got married. In 2014, right after it came out, it made it to number one on the Billboard 100 and was his first number one single in the United States, his first, and then his third the third best-selling song internationally of 2014. So, All of Me. The next piece is another contemporary jazz type piece dating back quite a long time. Birdland was a club in New York. In fact, John, one of our alto players, grew up in New York and went and saw a number of bands in the 50s when he was very young, 50s and 60s, some of the bands that you would know about. I asked him about it the other day and he said it was a great place. And Joe Swaniel, anyway, he wrote a lot of pop rock stuff, and he wrote this piece for Weather Report, which was a band, which was a tribute to the Birdland nightclub in New York City. And that club was open from 49 to 65, and the word is on the streets, Charlie Parker was known as Birdman. And he went to that club so often that it morphed into the name of that club was Birdland. I cannot find where it was originally. I can just find that it was operated from 49 to 65, but that's kind of where the name came from. The piece hung around quite a bit. Manhattan Transfer in the late 70s in 1979 won a Grammy for this piece. And Quincy Jones in 1989, 10 years later, won two Grammys for his version of this piece. So it's hung around quite a long time. One of the other interesting comments about this piece and doing some research on it, a jazz writer from the time in 1978 interview with the group when they first recorded this thing, Manhattan Transfer, and the recording they took to publish and be on records at the time, they did it in one take. Practice, boom, gone. That's very rare, even for a group that plays a piece every single day. So, anyway, here's our version of Birdland.
our concert today. We always have so much fun performing to a full auditorium. My name is Kristen Groves, and I am the board member in charge of Ways and Means, so it's my job to figure out how the band is going to make money. We are a 501c3 organization, so we do rely on donations to cover a lot of our costs. I just want to share a few quick ways that you can help us with that. First is to come to our concert. Bring people with you, sign up for our email newsletters so you know about our upcoming concerts, and then if you enjoy our music, on the way out in the lobby, there's some trumpet cases. Feel free to drop in a donation to help us out. You'll help us purchase music, pay for rehearsal space, pay for our concert band's performance venue. If you want to make a more formal donation, you can become a friend of the band. We have various membership levels and different benefits at the different levels of membership. Or if you own a business or you know someone who owns a business who would like to be a business sponsor, you can take out ads in our programs or you can sponsor concerts. We have different levels of membership for business as well. So thank you again for coming out today. I hope you enjoy the rest of the concert.
Speaking of sponsorship, I feel like many of you were here Christmas for our Christmas concert, and we had a sponsor for that concert. Diana Brooks, her law firm, sponsored that concert. Unfortunately, she had a very serious illness in the family and couldn't even be here herself. So I feel like we need to acknowledge her support for the band, even though it was in December. Thank you, Diana. I let her have the microphone at the band concert in March, and she talked 10 minutes. She must have had a band director we all know. Okay, so we're back to another pop tune, completely different, Barry Manilow piece, Copacabana. And he used to, a lot of American jazzers and pop people used to go to Rio and do the clubs down there. And some of them still do. It's kind of dangerous down there. But there was a club down there in Copacabana. There was one in New York as well. Anyway, Manilow went down there a lot and played in that club. And a couple of his friends and he sat around one day and wrote this piece. And it was his, it's kind of complicated here, it was his first gold single for a song that he wrote or co-wrote. And his only Grammy for best male vocal performance. But we know how great he is, but this is, you know, this was early in his career. This is in 79. So you'll like, this is another Latin piece. It kind of gets with it a little bit. Copacabana. We'll be right back. The next piece is Begin to Begin, which has been around a long time as well. And the history on this is a little bit. Cole Porter, who wrote a lot of things, wrote this piece while he was on a South Pacific cruise to Fiji. You know, so it got, but Sousa wrote Stars and Stripes in his brain on a ship coming back from England. So these genius people can just do this. You know, they think about it and they go home to a piano and bing, they're good. This piece didn't catch on very well at first. It's kind of complicated and you have to pay attention to it. But back when it was written in the late 30s, that's just kind of the way it was. But a band led by Artie Shaw, who ended up being very, very popular after he recorded this piece. When he recorded this piece, it kind of ticked along a little bit, and then he did this with his band, and it put his band on the map, and it put this piece on the map forever. It's still very popular. And it got to be such a big deal that Harry James, Benny Goodman, Tommy Dorsey, Glenn Miller, they all picked it up and recorded it. And it's a really, really interesting piece. And you just heard Mark Woodard on the alto saxophone in Copa, and he's gonna be this fancy Artie Shaw clarinet soloist, no pressure at all, on Begin to Begin, right? Well, pretty good, huh? A couple of things, putting my music theory, music educator thing. The thing about what we do with this band and a lot of other bands and why big bands are still popular. Think about it. We've done Barry Manilow. We've done John Legend. We've done music from the 30s. The one thing they have in common is a melody. There's a tune to them. And if you pay attention, you know what's going on, and it's easy to keep up with it. It's kind of hard to do some of that on the radio, you know. And there's an audience for that. But I've never seen any of that transposed for a band. But anyway, we thank you for hanging around with us and doing what we do and supporting what we do. We're going to play another big band piece now that has been around since the 20s. It was originally called Bugle Call Blues, and it was a small group in New Orleans called the Rhythm Kings in 22. And they recorded it, and there were later renditions and carried on. And finally, when it went to publication and to copyright, it was called Bugle Call Rag. It's another tune that Benny Goodman, Glenn Miller, Duke Ellington, and all of those tune bands picked up. And most bands today, like ours, have it in their library. Bugle Call Rag. As you have seen, we have quite a few talented members in the group, and I'm going to ask, if you've had a solo today, please stand to be acknowledged. Even trombone, trumpets, they have all had that, and thank you. And also like the rhythm section to stand up. You can't have a band without a rhythm section. Y'all stand up over there. Thank you. And the trumpets are already standing, you know. Trombones, wave at them. And then our saxophones sit on the front row and block the view for everybody. But anyway, we're We have a really good group, and all of these people play in the concert band, which has 80 people in it. And our spring concert is on May the 11th. It's the Saturday of Mother's Day weekend. We typically do our concerts on Sunday, but since Sunday was Mother's Day, we decided to do our concert on Saturday so you could be with your families. Now, that's going to be a very interesting concert. We're going to feature three of our trumpets on Leroy Anderson's Bugler's Holiday. We're going to play one of Leonard Bernstein's most famous overtures. We're going to play some Harry Potter themes. We're going to do an Irish tune. We're going to do a couple of marches. And at that concert, we always end the year with Stars and Stripes. And we have a piece specifically to honor Memorial Day for those we lost defending our nation. And beyond, before we turn the page and go to another piece, we need to all thank Tom Keener for putting on these programs here at the library. We got somebody else. This fellow standing in front, Ray Akin, our associate director. Ray and I met as freshmen at SMU a really long time ago. And I have a one-liner for that. LBJ was president. Anyway, that's really a long time ago. Anyway, Ray and I hit it off then. We were in the trumpet section at SMU, and he taught and wrote and arranged, had his own big band for a number of years. When we came out of COVID, we were trying to get going, and I was just covered up with stuff, and our members were struggling. I called Ray. I said, I need a little help. Will you come out? And he stayed, thank heavens. But one of the things that works so well, this is his specialty. And he does about 80% of the work with this band, and I do about 20. And then at the concert band, I do about 80% with that band, and he does about 20. But the good thing is we have two sets of ears listening to both bands all the time. And it's and we tell different stories. You know, he tells stories, and I tell stories, and the band doesn't get too bored, like we hope the audience doesn't. But anyway, we have a closer that I think you'll enjoy that is very fitting. We were talking about melodies and singers and all. Last summer, we lost Tony Bennett, one of the great singers of all of our lifetime. Even if you're very young, Tony Bennett, you would know him. He even did a TV special with Lady Gaga. And he passed away, and he retired after those that video and those concerts with Gaga. He had been fighting Alzheimer's for 9 years, and it finally got to where he just couldn't keep going. So he retired right after that. And until about 6 months before he passed, 3 days a week, his accompanists came to his home in New York, and they rehearsed. He was still singing and taking care of business because that's what was the love of his life. His real name was Antonio Benedetto, and he ran into a guy named Frank Sinatra, and he said, Tony Bennett, that Antonio Benedetto stuff's too hard to say and too hard to sell. Just start going by Tony Bennett. And they became fast friends forever, to the point that Tony Bennett opened a fine arts academy in New York in Frank Sinatra's name. It's in Queens. So those guys were just fast friends and whatever. And the great Tony Bennett made a great song out of I Left My Heart in San Francisco. Ray? Thank you.
Do I hear an encore?
That's good, because we have one.
Otherwise,
just go home. But thank you again for being here, and bring some friends. And if you've never heard the concert band, you need to come hear us. We do 4 concerts a year, just like this group. We do a Veterans Day in the fall, like this group does. We do Christmas in the winter, like this group does. We do, in February and March, we do a Pops concert with movies and musicals. And then we do a late spring concert, like this group does. And we commemorate Memorial Day and play all sorts of very interesting things. It's free. All of our concerts are free. And bring a friend. You know, there's 800 seats over there. There's 265 here. You know, that's pretty good. But if all of you brought 2 people, we'd fill the house. But we'd like to see you there. We would also like to thank you again and again and again for coming out today and supporting our organization. And if you want to keep up with us, there's 2 ways to do it. You can look at us on Facebook. But we have an email system, and there's cards out there. Tony has it at the front at the table. We don't do anything with that email address but send you information about the band. That's the only thing it does. We'll send you about a concert. We'll send you about anything that's going on about both bands, or if something crazy happened with bad weather, we had to cancel so that you didn't come out on the wrong day. But you can sign that up, or you can follow us on Facebook. But please consider a donation of some kind, or even like Diana and a couple of other people, you can sponsor a concert and you get a lot of coverage for your company. Or we've even had some families sponsor a concert for a loved one. So anyway, Mr. Akin, it's time to go to work. Y'all will like this, I hope.